Good morning. One of the oldest and most beloved greetings in the church is grace and peace, and your responses, and also with you, grace and peace for the Lord Jesus Christ be with each of you this morning. Thank you very much. I appreciate that very much. I'm glad you're here. I want to welcome you to the worship service. If you're a guest visiting today, and I've already met some, my name is Jay Smith. I'm pleased to welcome you on behalf of this church. We don't take lightly. You could be a lot of places today, but you've chosen to worship and to worship with us, and we're thankful for that. If you are a guest visiting, a couple of things. There are Get Connected cards on the pews all around you. Just fill out that information, put that in the offering plate a little bit later. We'd love to reconnect about the ministries of our church. Also, after the service, to my left, your right, these double doors, or you can see me at the back door, a member of our hospitality team would love to give you some information as well related to the ministries of our church, and we have a gift for you. So if you're a guest visitor today, just keep those two things in mind. If you are interested in one of the books related to the sermon series that we're in right now, Let Your Life Speak by Parker Palmer, the books are in and they're in the office. And if you can afford $10, just put $10 in that little offering plate and take a book. We'd love for you to have it. If you can't afford $10, just get one of the books, and that's all right. So just know that those are there for those that might want to go a little deeper as we move through this series together. Let Your Life Speak by Parker Palmer. The books are in the office. Finally, the insert in your bulletin lets you know some of the times that are options for the Believe series, which is going to start back on February 1st. This particular 10-week series deals with how we can act more like Jesus. It's not as important just to know what we believe, but how we live out what we believe is most important of all. And this next 10 weeks, we'll focus on that. We actually have a video that we want to share with you. Before we hit that video, I want you to be aware the Monday morning option is actually at 10 o'clock and not 9 o'clock as is on your insert. But if you have you need to re-register even this semester. If you were in a group last semester, please sign up once again for this semester and just use that. We have a special video related to the Believe study. I want to share it with you now. What's that? Number four, I'm being told. The Wesleyan Quadrilateral 4. I was with the confirmation.
Today, plan. Though, you are going to be so glad that you came to church. I've got an amazing... guest speaker, a very good friend of mine who is a comedian, but...
I only know because I saw it at the early service. Go four, right on down a little bit. Four, right there. Believe is invitational. There you go, friend. Thank you.
Today, though, you are going to be so glad that you came to church. I've got an amazing...
He is convinced to share with us, isn't he? That's the one he's clicking. We'll wait. I tell you what. He's not going to control what we do in this church, so I don't even know who he is. So we're going to get the right one for you next week, all right? We'll forego that. The main thing you need to know is Believe begins again Wednesday, February 1st. So you've got this Sunday and the next couple of Sundays to register for the new Believe series. We'll get a video for you next week, all right? Yes, sir. Believe is learning to act like Jesus, this particular series. All right?
We can get it next time.
We'll get it next time. We're in good shape. Friends, we've all come, whether things go the way we want them to or not, we've come for the exact same reason, and we've come to worship God. Let us worship the Lord. I'm so glad you're here.
We have one other announcement also, and that is the rose on the altar this morning is placed there to the glory of God and in honor of Susanna Alice McGill, our newest member. She was born December 28th. She is the daughter of Amy and Matt McGill, the granddaughter of Jeff and Molly McGill, and the little sister of Vivian Kate McGill, who is standing up in the back so she can see the rose on the altar. We are very happy to celebrate with the entire McGill family and welcome this newest member to our congregation. Now let us go to the Lord in silent prayer. I invite you to stand this morning as we begin our worship service with the call to worship from Psalm 63. You may find that in your red hymnal on page 788. Would you please stand? Page 788. You, God, are my God. I seek you. My soul thirsts for you. My flesh faints for you, as in a dry and weary land where no water is. Because your steadfast love is better than life, my lips will praise you.
So I will bless you as long as I live. I will lift up my hands to all your name.
And as together we call upon the name of the Lord, I invite you to join in singing our opening hymn, number 57, Oh for a Thousand Tongues to Sing.
Thank you.
remain standing, let us join our voices together as we affirm our faith as a community of faith. The words are printed in your bulletin with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Our reading this morning is from Romans chapter 1, 1 through 7. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God, the gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, regarding his son, who as to his human nature was a descendant of David, and who through the Spirit of holiness was declared with power to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Through him and for his name's sake, we received grace and apostleship to call people from among all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith. And you also are among those who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all in Rome, who are loved by God and called to be saints, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
As together we prepare our hearts for prayer this morning, I invite you to join in singing the second verse of number 452, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Let's pray. Faithful God, we are gathered once again, members of one family, united by our common trust in and dependence on you. We thank you that even when the future is unclear, even when we don't feel fine, even when we aren't okay, even when we're not really sure if we ever will be again, your love remains constant, and the confidence and assurance that you give are always available to us. We thank you for hearing our prayers, and we praise you for being a God who's worthy of our trust, for being a God who cares about us and about our needs. And we confess, Lord, that we often confuse our wants with our needs, but we bring them all to you anyway, trusting that in your wisdom,
you will sort them out. We ask today for healing for those battling illness. We ask for peace where there is violence, comfort where there is grief, and clarity where there is depression and confusion. And on this weekend in particular, we are reminded that there are still far too many times that we fail to treat one another as we should. In spite of the lessons history should have taught us and the instructions that Scripture has given us, we continue to judge one another because of the kind of house we live in or don't, because of the clothes we wear, the cars we drive, the money we make, or even the color of our skin. And in the struggle for social justice and equality, there are so many battles still being fought. Forgive us for prolonging and contributing to the problem. Forgive us for the hostility and the disdain we sometimes show our fellow brothers and sisters, all of whom are your children, more like us than we are different. Change our hearts to be like yours. We join our voices with the prophets asking for your justice to roll down like water and your righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. Let us not rest until your will is truly done on earth as it is in heaven. We thank you for your patience with us, God, for your consistent, loving guidance, correcting us when we're wrong, teaching us your way, and giving us good examples to follow. And there is no example more precious to us than Jesus. We bring all of these prayers and praises in his glorious name, and we pray together the prayer he first taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have indeed been blessed to be blessings to others, and one of those ways we can do that is through the giving of our tithes and our offerings. So I invite our ushers to come forward at this time to receive those.
Thank you.
Will you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we come to you in this winter season with the knowledge that the plants and the grasses that we depend on for beauty and sustenance are in a time of rest. But during this time of rest, as the winter winds blow, their roots continue to grow and be stronger. And Father, we ask that with the Sabbath day rest that you have decreed for us, that we will take advantage not only of a day of rest, but of a time to strengthen our roots in your love and affection through prayer and study. And Father, we thank you for this great church. We thank you for the service through sharing of talents of our staff and volunteers. And Father, we ask that we continue to reach out to the community around us with a message that you have far beyond the walls of this church. We thank you for the tithes and offerings that make this possible. We ask that you expand them as only you can do. And we ask all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
All right, kids, I'd love for you to come down front and join me for some time together. Good morning. I am so happy to see all of you this morning. Got some more friends joining us. So, did you all know, I don't know if you knew this about me, but I think I'm a pretty good artist, and I drew a picture to share with you today. We'll see what you guys think of it. Okay. This is a picture of my ear with my earring. What do you think? Does that look like my ear? Maybe this one. No? No? Well, Jordan, what is it? A question mark? Well, okay. Yeah, that's true. It probably looks a little bit more like a question mark than it looks like my ear. You're probably right. I'll work on my drawing. But since we've got a question mark here, what do you know about a question mark? Why? What is that for? Helen? The end of a question, right? I'm asking a whole lot of questions this morning. So can you all think for a minute of a question that you've ever wondered, like why do I have to eat my vegetables before I eat my dessert? Is that a good question? Like, why is the sky blue? And why does an elephant have those big ears and that long trunk? Can you all think of any why questions you've ever wondered? I wonder why. Well, it turns out that why is a question that kids ask a lot, but it's also an important question for grown-ups to ask. And so anytime you have a question, who would you go to? Who would you ask if you had a question, Abraham? You would go and ask God? That's an excellent idea. Who would you ask, Jay Gardner? You'd ask Jesus? Has God given us people here on earth right here that we can see right now that we might ask? What about if you're at home and you have a question, who would you ask? Maybe your brother? Maybe your mom or your dad? Yes? How about if you're at school and you have a question, who would you ask? Anybody besides Abraham paying attention? Yes. Melissa? Your teacher? Very nice. Okay. How about if you're here at church? Could you ask if you had a question, Jay Gardner? Right, your Sunday school teacher? How about this guy in the black robe over there? You think you could ask him a question if you had one? Yeah, and you could ask me a question anytime. So I want you guys to keep asking questions because that's important for us no matter how old that we are. But Abraham was right. We can always ask God a question. So let's thank God that he listens to all the questions that we have. Owen is going to pray with you guys. Will you all pray with him just like you do with me?
Dear God, thank you for always listening to our questions. Help us to listen for your answers. Amen.
Thank you. All right, if you are second grade or under, let's go to Children's Church.
We began last week a new sermon series entitled Let Your Life Speak. It's based on a book by Parker Palmer, as I mentioned during our announcement time this morning. We're looking at how we can let our lives speak. That's a Quaker saying and a Quaker phrase, actually. And how we can let our lives speak through purpose, through passion, through pain, and through promise. And so for the next two Sundays after this one, we'll be exploring this a little further. Today, we're looking at how to let our lives speak through passion. Our gospel lesson is Matthew chapter 10. I've shortened it a bit. It's Matthew 10 verses 26 to 28. Just two verses, Matthew chapter 10 verses 26 to 28. For those of you who are able, would you please stand in honor of the reading of the gospel? Listen now for the word of the Lord. Jesus is speaking to his disciples. So do not be afraid of them, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. This is the word of God for the people of God. And thanks be to God. In his book, Let Your Life Speak, Parker Palmer shares what many of us probably already know, that on December 1st, 1955, in Montgomery, Alabama, Rosa Parks, who was a seamstress in her early 40s at the time, did something that she was not supposed to do. As most of you know, she sat down at the front of a bus in one of the seats reserved for whites. It was, as Parker Palmer describes, a dangerous, daring, and provocative act in a racist society. Legend has it that years later, a graduate student came to Rosa Parks and asked her, "Why did you sit down at the front of the bus on that day?" And Rosa Parks did not say that she sat down to launch a movement, because her motives, it turns out, were more elemental than that. Rosa Parks said this, "I sat down because I was tired." But she did not mean that her feet were tired. They may have been tired as well. What she meant was that her soul was tired. Her heart was tired. Her whole being was tired of playing by the racist rules of the day, of denying. She was tired of denying her soul's claim for selfhood.
You see, Rosa Parks, her why stemmed from knowing that she was a child of God. She was a woman of faith. And she could no longer live, as Parker Palmer describes, as an undivided person, an undivided life, whereby what I do with the outer parts of my life, the way I live my life, is incongruent with my inner life, what is on the inside. And so in this moment of definition, of defining who she was, she sat down in order to stand up for herself. And in so doing, she was no longer divided. She was not living a divided life, because if we live a divided life, if our outer way that we conduct our lives does not match up with the inner, deepest parts that we know are true about ourselves. And as Christian people, as people of faith, we know that our deepest core identity comes from God and no one else. And so Rosa Parks did not know whether she would wind up in jail, which she did, but she knew on that day that a physical jail had nothing to compare to the jail that her soul and her heart had been imprisoned in for those 40 some odd years. You see, when we live a divided life, little by little, our souls begin to wither and fade. I think of Rosa Parks when I read these words of Jesus to his disciples. I think of Jesus himself saying to her, "Do not be afraid of them. There is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed. There's nothing hidden that will not be made known. I tell you, whatever I tell you in the dark." And what would he have said to her in the dark? He would have said to her, "You are my child. And whatever you have heard in the dark, speak in the daylight. Whatever is whispered in your ear, proclaim it from the rooftops," or in this case, on the buses. Jesus would have said to her, as he says to us, when we seek to live divided no more, "Do not be afraid of those who can kill the body." I don't know about you, but I'm a chicken at heart. I don't like pain, and I don't like to be mistreated. But Jesus gives a truth here. You don't be afraid of the one who can kill the body only and not the soul. You fear the one who can kill both body and soul. And that's what dies little by little when we live divided, when our outward actions contradict the inner truth. That's when our souls are killed. Now, on the reverse of that, our souls become most alive. How does our soul and our hearts, how do they soar? How do they find purpose? I suggest to you that whenever we are true to who God has created us to be, and when we live our lives from a place of passion, when we follow our passion, this gives life to our souls. Now, I feel like I have to give a word of caution here, a qualifier here, because as you know, not just any passion will do. People are passionate about a lot of things. What are some things people passionate about? Some people are passionate about, and these are all good things, maybe flowers. Some people are passionate about books or art or their pets or food. Some of you are thinking about lunch right now. You're passionate about, when's he going to get us out of here? People are passionate about, some people are passionate about sports. Anybody from Tennessee here? You're not from Tennessee now, Owen. You're from Kentucky. Have you noticed in Tennessee, I don't know if you've noticed, in Tennessee, they are crazy about football. Have y'all noticed? It's embarrassing how out of perspective. I just wish they could be as in proper perspective of their college athletics as we are here in Kentucky. Don't you wish that? You see, it's not passion for passion's sake. We went to Nashville, the Christians over here. The guy was sitting by me, and he was pretty passionate for Vanderbilt, the Commodores. I heard some things that I hadn't heard in a very, very long time. And Steve Ray, I thought of you as a referee. Where's Steve? I mean, this guy, and it helped me. Lucretia asked me, she said, I thought you would be a little more fired up at the game. Well, I was afraid of this guy. He was bigger than me, and he was just, Fred, he was in a rage, wasn't he? And really that helped me, because I can tell you, there was a time in my life, I was watching, if the refs went against God's team, you just fill in the blank, whatever that is for you. I mean, it's not passion for passion's sake. What we're passionate about makes all the difference. I love how Parker Palmer, he talks about true vocation. He talks about it in this way. It's when we connect and join ourselves and service. That's passion. When our deepest selves connect with passion, Frederick Buechner puts it this way, and Palmer quotes him in his book, the vocation is that place where God calls us, where our deep gladness, I thought it was going to be up there, our deep gladness meets the world's deep needs. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, that's passion worth living for. That the place of our deep gladness meets the world's deep needs. And some of you are sitting there, you're thinking, Dr. J, I've been retired for years. I don't really know what this sermon series has to do with me. Friends, it doesn't matter if you are still getting a paycheck or not. I hope to God that living and vocation do not end with retirement. Life doesn't end. We are still living out what God calls us to do in the world. I remember about 20 years ago, I can't believe it's been 20 years ago, my father retired from the phone company, and my dad was one of these 14, 15 hour a day kind of guys. He would leave at 7 in the morning, and it would be 7, 8 o'clock, many nights before he got home. And so he worked hard, and this was his life. And when he retired, he would tell you that first winter was just miserable, because he was just like a caged animal. Now in the summertime, the springtime, those were better because he could get out and he could do things. But my father, when he retired, he had to figure out what is it that his life is about now. And what my dad did, and you have to figure this out yourself, but he threw his lot in with Habitat for Humanity. I mean, he can build anything. He can fix anything. That's just something he's always been able to do. And I cannot do any of those things. Can I get an amen from my wife? I did not get that gene, but that was, and so there was no reason why that had been his life. Why in his retirement could he not find a way to channel that? And so he threw his lot in with Habitat. So don't tell me you're retired and so you don't have a vocation anymore. You don't have a calling anymore. Friends, when we can connect ourselves with a deep sense of service in the world, making a difference in the world, that's following our passion. I was in a board meeting on Monday. I'm on the Foundry board. Some of you are familiar. Many of you are familiar with the Foundry. It's the Foundry Christian Community Center. It's at the end of 11th Street here. One of our former pastors here's at State Street, Mike Powers, was the district superintendent, and he gave birth to the Foundry. He bought the property and had a vision for that, and now the Foundry has a preschool for 3- and 4-year-olds and an after-school mentoring program and other programs to try to help the kids in the west side of Bowling Green get a level playing field. So many of them are so far behind, once they start kindergarten, they never catch up. And so the Foundry has this mission to connect with the kids and the children and their families in this particular area of Bowling Green. And some of you are mentors and some of you are volunteers there. And we were in the board meeting this last Monday, and there was a new board member on the phone. She was joining us by a conference call. And I got to the meeting late, but I gathered as I sat down and found my place, they were going around, and the question was, why are you on the Foundry board? Well, nobody ever asked me that. I mean, they have lunch. I like lunch. Nobody ever asked, why are you on the Foundry board? And people were going around. And Miss Harriet's son, Alex, was there. Well, your dad was there, and he was sitting beside me, and it came to him, and he's like, I just have a passion for kids. I have a passion to help. And another lady said, I just have a heart for the poor in this community. And another person talked about, I lost track of how many times the word passion was mentioned. And when it came my turn, I didn't say, you know, I like the lunch, which I do. What would you say? Why are you on the boards? Why do you give the life that you give to certain things in this world? What I said was, and Cindy mentioned it in her prayer this morning, what I told them was, my favorite part of the Lord's Prayer is these words. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And whenever I can spend any of my day, any of my time, helping to make that kingdom more real and known on earth as it is in heaven, that's what I want to be about. I'm passionate about that. I sat on the Board of Ordained Ministry. The Board of Ordained Ministry in the Methodist, United Methodist Church, is the group of folks that reviews and encourages and tries to support persons who are coming up for ordination in our conference. And there's questions they have to answer. They have to present a sermon and a learning project and a Bible study. And you're interviewed every year going through this process. I have a favorite question that I always ask, or almost always ask, every person. These are persons who are already serving in churches. Most of them are pastors. Many of them are serving, or all of them are serving in some way in a local congregation. So they're already in ministry. And I always ask the ones that come before our little small group, I ask them, what is most life-giving to you in ministry? What is it? Now don't worry, I'm not going to tell your church, but what is it that you would do for free? What are you passionate about? It kills me to have somebody come in and you get this vibe, you get this sense that nothing is at stake. Does nothing matter? It's not about answering the right questions and having the right theological answers. Is there anything at stake? And so I love to hear. What are you passionate about? Those of you that know me, you know it's the year-end statistical reports. Hallelujah. That's what I'm doing right now. I hate the year-end statistical reports. You didn't know it. My whole salary, you pay me only to do the year-end statistical reports. I would do everything else free. Who's on the finance committee? Do not repeat that. But you get what I'm, you know what I'm getting at. You see, when we become in touch with our passion, and our passion, that is the why. The passion is the why before the what. And if we come to understand what our why is it that I get up every day and put one foot in front of the other? If I understand my why, then my what can become clearer. A very good friend of mine, about 3 months ago,
we were in a meeting and he pulled out his cell phone. He said, Jay, I want you to see this video. I didn't know who Michael Jr. was. Michael Jr., you may know, is an African-American comedian, stand-up comic. And he showed me this video. And the video is entitled, Knowing Your Why, or Know Your Why. I want to share that with you.
But the key really isn't to know what, the key is to know why. Because when you know your why, you have options on what your what can be. For instance, my why is to inspire people to walk in purpose. My what is stand-up comedy. My what is writing books. My what can be going out with some friends to eat. In fact, another what that has moved me towards my why is a web series that we have out now called Break Time. So every Wednesday at 3 o'clock, you should subscribe to the channel. We do a series called Break Time on YouTube. So 3 o'clock, we drop a new episode. One episode in particular, I'm about to show you a clip to. We were in Winston-Salem. So Break Time, this is how it works. I travel the country, I do stand-up comedy, probably an hour, hour and a half at an event. And in the middle of my show, I'll just sit down and start talking to the audience. And funny just happens. Or I'll meet somebody who's really interesting. So I met this one guy, and he said that he teaches music at a school. I was like, all right, you teach music, you know, can you sing? And then I'm just going to show you the clip. Check it. So you're a musical director.
Yes, cool. Sir.
All right, so let me get a couple bars of like Amazing Grace. Can you do the first part of that? Go ahead.
Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Wow. That bro could sing. You know what I'm saying? All right. Now, what you give me the version is if your uncle just got out of jail, you got shot in the back when you was a kid, I'm just saying, let me see the hood version real quick, if you know which version I'm talking about. Just see if that exists. Let me see what you got.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
Here's the thing. The first time I asked him to sing, he knew what he was doing. The second time I asked him to sing, he knew why he was doing it. When you know your why, your what has more impact because you're walking in or towards your purpose. The series is called How Do I Know?
It's good, but we're not going to watch it again. Here's the take on. If you and I want to have deep, deep purpose, we have to first understand why. What's our why? And when we know our why, then the what and the variations of the what become clearer. We're going to be tonight, our confirmation, where's our confirmands? I see Jack and Davis and any other, our confirmation, we were with our confirmation folks, yesterday, there's Owen. Man, we had a great time at Lucan. It rained the whole time, but we had a great time. Tonight, they're going to serve the meal at Room in the Inn. Why? Why that what? That what is because our why as a church is to connect ourselves with the kingdom of God and to make it known and real. And so our what tonight is we're going to make some brownies and some cornbread. Right, Davis? You know how to make cornbread? I do not. Do you know your why? You may be struggling with your what in this life, and you may be struggling with the what because you have not come to clarity on the why. Because the why precedes the what. Would you pray with me? Gracious and holy God, we thank you that you have created each and every one of us in your image. We thank you that you call us to be your children, not just so our lives will be blessed and good, but you have called us to be your children so that we can make your kingdom on this earth more real and known through us. You do it through persons like Rosa Parks and Martin Luther King Jr. You do it through folks just like us. Oh God, give us a passion. Give us a why that is worth living for each and every day. And those of us that may be struggling with our what in this world, may we continue to seek you and to come to an understanding of our why that will fuel and empower the what. To the glory of your kingdom on this earth, we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who was your passion and your purpose made flesh. And all God's children did say, amen. Dear friends, before we sing the closing hymn, I would just invite you. The altar is always open in a United Methodist Church. Maybe you need to pray about your why, or maybe you need to pray about your what today. I would simply offer that invitation if it would be helpful to you to come and to spend some time in reflecting on that as we stand and sing together. I think it's I Am Thine, O Lord. Is that right, Lee?
Would you please stand and join in singing with passion and with purpose, number 419. I am thine, O Lord.
Yeah.
my sisters and brothers, my prayer for you and my prayer for me is that this day and every day in the week ahead, that we might have opportunity to connect the why of our lives with the what that we do on any given day to the glory of God, and that God's kingdom might be seen and made real on this earth as it is in heaven. To the glory of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Go in peace.